Now, when I got there, I had no idea where to begin. And I bumped into someone whose name you may recognize, Ruth First. And Ruth First said to me, I looked a bit flustered, and she said, oh, you've never taught before. Have you read Freire? And I had read Freire. And she said, do what Freire said. Start by asking the students what they know and what they don't know. Start from the world of the students. That's what I did. Okay, now more related to your book, your co-edited volume, Kathleen, I'd like to situate a little bit about what a sociolinguistics of the South could mean. In 1991, the Brazilian physicist and friend of Paulo Freire's, Márcio Campos, coined the verb suliar-se in Portuguese, which means to south oneself. And yet he critiqued and questioned the unquestioned colonial inheritance in Brazilian education of teaching young Brazilian learners in the Southern Hemisphere to orient themselves spatially in the same way as learners in the Northern Hemisphere, who look at the Northern Star and locate the East on the right and the West on the left. Campos said, this doesn't make sense spatially for us in the Southern Hemisphere when we look at the Southern Star, the Southern Cross. And for us, it's exactly the opposite. For us, East and West are the opposite. And so what an aberration it is for us in the Southern Hemisphere to continue looking up to the global North and trying to see the world as the global North sees it. And so for him, the verb in Portuguese, suliar-se, to south oneself, involves questioning these presuppositions of what is hegemonic or what is standard. And Freire took that from him and expanded on that and used it in some of his works, the idea of to south oneself, suliar-se. Also in terms of Southern perspectives, the Portuguese thinker Boaventura Santos showed us that the expansion of the capitalist hegemony of the global North was made possible by and justified by modern science claiming to be the only and universal form of rationality and knowledge. This promoted the so-called abyssal line and the epistemicide of other possible knowledges. And he says, and I quote, without establishing a more balanced relationship among rival knowledges, policies aiming at social justice will end up furthering social injustice. He also said that the objectivity of science does not imply neutrality. Science can be put at the service of hegemonic globalization, just as it can be put at the service of counter-hegemonic globalization. So for Santos, counter-hegemonic practices or knowledges of the South are mainly practices not considered to be scientific by the criteria of the science of the global North. And here lies the task of counter-hegemonic science, to challenge the criteria for scientific truth of the hegemonic global North. Those of you who have read Audre Lorde will remember her warning that the master's tools will never dismantle the master's house. So Kathleen, we have neighboring chapters in the 2017 book Entangled Discourses. And there in your chapter, you speak of the need to uncover ongoing entanglements and codependencies that crisscross what Santos called the abyssal line. It's really wonderful to see this work expanded and widely exemplified in the various studies that constitute your co-edited volume, Linguistics of the Global South. Congratulations, Kathy.
Then Mario, thank you so much for that incredibly generous contribution to the launch of this book, but also to find a way to knit our histories together. I knew you had been in Mozambique, I just didn't know exactly when you had been in Mozambique, and so that is just quite a phenomenal coincidence of time. So thank you so much for that. And of course, many of the contributors to this particular volume have been following your work very, very carefully, not least of all because many of us also have some connection with Mozambique and also connections with Brazil. So this is really a very moving contribution that you've just made. So just to give a little bit of background from the side of the editors, we've co-edited this. It's really a collaborative effort that comes out of something called the Southern Multilingualisms and Diversities Consortium. This was, it was a very loose arrangement of people who started to become extremely uncomfortable with the so-called multilingual term as coined by people from the global north about understanding what multilingualism was from a perspective that seemed to be particularly Eurocentric and even worse, Anglocentric. And we wondered why it was that people who had been working with multilingualism in multilingual societies in the global south had simply been written out of the sort of articulation of how people should understand multilingualism. And there seemed to be a new doxa appearing around about 2010 about, well, multilingualism is this and it is not that. And people who talk about multilingualism as X are wrong. They simply don't understand what multilingualism is. These are people who came from Europe, where there are 286 languages originally, talking to people in the South where there are pretty close to 7,000 languages of the world. So this seemed really quite outrageous. So there was a conversation that was taking place by a number of people, including people at the University of the Western Cape, Christopher Stroud and colleagues whom you know very well, and also some of us at the University of South Australia and colleagues in India. And we proposed a loose arrangement of the Southern Multilingualisms and Diversities Consortium, including scholars, but also members of community-based organizations and research centers. And so this volume actually has been in gestation, if you like, from 2012. We launched the consortium in 2014 at this university, and it's involved conversations pretty much including people from many different parts of the world. So if you don't mind just trotting along. Thank you. So the volume itself is broken into three sections. There are what we call stories of the South. Rather than sort of narratives and dialogues and doxa coming from the South, we're suggesting that there are many stories, there are many ways of understanding multilingualism from the global South. There isn't a singular way. It depends on the context, it depends on where people have come from, it depends on their histories. Many of these histories, of course, are layered with cycles of coloniality. And the second section is really looking at what Southern decolonial scholarship might look like, and then also looking at Southern decolonial methodologies. And we really are quite, we're trying to assert the Southernness of the decolonial methodologies and the Southernness of decolonial scholarship, because we see a tendency towards reappropriating terms like decoloniality from Northern scholars who themselves assume that one can replace colonial discourses and post-colonial discourses with simply renaming them as decolonial discourses. Mm-hmm. So we're saying, no, they're actually Southern discourses of decoloniality. But there's a plurality of voices, histories, knowledges, and we're thinking about communalities of care, hope, and love. And with these, we have really dealt and leant quite heavily on the scholars from South America. And we also see that there's a swelling, unhurried river of Southern decoloniality with many tributaries. So there are, of course, master narratives that are hurried, neglectful, and overwriting of the past, presence, and futures of Southern narratives. And these have no place in the sociolinguistics of the South. So we've illustrated what we mean by sociolinguistics of the South with contributions by people like Reynaldo Macias, who talks of Chicana sociolinguistics, Cree nation language reclamation and voice, the a consortium actually of contributors and authors to that particular paper, decolonizing language discourses from Nepal. And then we also have contributions of two PhD, recent PhD completions at this university and another scholar from this university, Sam Osborne, Janet Armitage, and Nisha Billing, Stanford Billinghurst. And so I think that's it. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Lynn Morrow.
And now I'd like to introduce Mara Barbosa from the University of Texas, talking about the dynamics of language and inequality in education. And you'll hear my timer.
Hello. Thank you so much for the opportunity and for being here. I've learned a lot. And thanks for the opportunity to talk about this book that I just read, and I enjoyed the reading a lot. So I'd like to start talking a little bit about what we have learned in these last few days so that you can map this book into the conference and into Freire's work. So Freire's ideas around context and the importance of critically reflecting upon the subject's reality instead of adopting Eurocentric models are crucial to any kind of positive social transformation that we may aspire. Eurocentric models that do not consider the particularities of our realities will only reinforce the status quo and allow powerful groups to keep their privileges at the expense of historically marginalized populations. And during this conference, the need to abandon a naive perception of reality, and as Paulo Freire puts it, perceiving the very act of perception, was discussed along with different ways in which we are creating conditions for our students and communities to grow from a fatalistic perspective towards critical hope. And critical hope can move subjects to take more active roles and actions that will result in real transformation in their communities. And we are living times in which neoliberal, conservative, and even fascist ideas are trying to dominate our higher education institutions. And let's not be naive, these ideas were never completely expelled from higher education institutions, but the attacks that we are living now, they look different. They come both completely open and clear, like when representatives invade classrooms and yell at professors who, according to them, are teaching leftist content, or in more hidden forms, like when we are asked to redesign our curriculum to prepare students for their future technical tasks and teach students language that they will use in their specific jobs to make them more marketable, they say. But what they really mean is prepare workforce that can only do one very limited task and don't ask questions about their conditions. And limiting subjects' education to a technical education that will not give them conditions to even reflect about their realities is in the interest of neoliberalism, but not in the best interest of our students and communities. And limiting their education also means limiting their ability to transform their own realities. And when you talk about limiting subjects' education, we are talking about providing a more technical education at school. We are talking about preparing students for a job market and not to decode the word, a palabra, and the world, o mundo. And I need to translate that because of my pronunciation. It may not be clear. And we need critical pedagogy for that. We need our students to understand that, as Paulo Freire puts it, reading does not consist merely of decoding the writing word of language. Rather, it is preceded by and intertwined with knowledge of the word. The understanding attained by critical reading of a text implies perceiving the relationship between text and context. And only by following these principles and by resisting neoliberalism and fascism so they don't guide our practices, we will be able to guarantee that the word is not the privilege of few persons, but the right of everyone. And now that I tried to touch on the themes discussed during this conference, I will tell you a little bit about the book being launched in the sessions, The Dynamics of Language and Inequality in Education, Social and Symbolic Boundaries in the Global South. And you will understand why Freire could not have been receiving a better present today. So some time ago, I remember reading this book called Border and Rule about global immigration, capitalism, and the rise of racist nationality. And since then, I've been thinking about how capitalism needs borders. Capitalism needs to divide so it can guide, so it can give less value to one's work than others, and can bring, for example, Walmart to our countries and underpay us. And that's the only way rich countries can keep their levels of consumerism. But dynamics of language and inequality in education brings a discussion that I believe we need to have about how not only physical, but symbolical borders also play a role in maintaining the status quo. So each chapter in this book presents context in situations of oppression through education, through language. And that's, I think, was very interesting. We learned about the use of lingua geral, that is a lingua franca, based on the Tupi language So I think I will just skip to the last session of the book. The session three of the book brings us the ideas of transgression and agency, which Paulo Freire are essential in the struggle for justice and democracy. And in these dark times, with the rise of fascist and neoliberalist governments, they are putting public and higher education increasing under siege. It's crucial to remind ourselves of Freire's understanding of the empowering and democratic potential of education. And that's exactly what this book does. And that's why I believe that Freire could not have a better present than this book, a book that reports on the applications of his ideas and in the struggle for erasing inequalities in such dark times for education. And thank you.
Thank you, and now I'll introduce you to Sam Schultz.
I've made some notes and I'll try and stick to them, but I'll also chop out a section of them so that you don't cut me off, Bindi. I must admit, when Joel asked me if I would be open to speaking briefly about this book, The Dynamics of Language and Inequality in Education, I was pleased, but a little apprehensive. I'm not a linguist. I don't work in the field of language studies. So my apprehension grew from a sense that to engage with this text and speak with any authority required that I already work within the explicit field. But of course, as critical educators, there are myriad points of intersection that connect us. And it wasn't until I started engaging with the chapters that I was reminded, and this seems such an oversight now, that when we cling to the contours of what we know, we really close down possibilities for dialogue, collaboration, and therefore change, which I believe are the very essences of the conference that I'm very sad to have missed owing to teaching responsibilities this week. But it's with this sense of openness that I offered the following few notes. So the book seeks to explore how and where linguistic inequalities continue to work through both old and new types of boundaries that structure oppression and resistance. It does so by establishing a conceptualization of boundaries as relational constructs that mediate inclusion and exclusion, drawing to attention how difference is produced and enforced, particularly through the establishment of center-periphery relations. During moments of boundary crossing, or as outlined in the opening chapter, attempted crossings, these boundaries are brought to life. Although the focus of the collection is primarily the Pacific, Asia, Middle East, Africa, and Latin America, these ideas couldn't be more salient in the Australian context, particularly now, a nation located in the Global South, but discursively connected to the imperial centre, which we know is geographically illogical. The imperialism inherent in this fantasy continues to be firmed up by successive conservative governments in Australia whose aggressive border control policies, literally and figuratively, construct boundaries within and without. And they've set the tone for narrow models of education, which this collection speaks to powerfully, if by de facto. The opening chapter explains, under conditions of conservatism, repression, and censorship, teachers and researchers need to deal with the relational, negotiated, and fluid nature of knowledge alongside its boundedness within ideological categories. So the notion that knowledge is plural and is integral to this collection and an invaluable takeaway for any readers. I'm going to jump down to chapter two, in which Joel and Cassandra explore race and educational inequality at the borderlands, highlighting the nuanced ways that soft and hard boundaries might be theorized and navigated. And really interesting here, I thought, was their combined discussion of the fine-grained work of race as a border with multiple complex histories, particular to place, but sharing in the function of sustaining and naturalizing social divisions. For those of us like me who routinely occupy the center, and in Australia, that is oftentimes teachers who predominantly draw from the Anglo-dominated mainstream, the boundaries drawn by race are so often experienced as natural and normal, as invisible. And that's a dangerous place for teachers to occupy if we collectively are to teach in advance of social equity. As these writers make clear in the chapter, boundaries can take on sharp and immediate form when you are, in contrast, the traveller, the border crosser. I'll jump down to chapter eight, where Carolyn McKinney draws on Ngugi wa Thiong'o's framing of colonialism. So the reality that while the bullet enabled the physical subjugation of colonial rule in South Africa, language was the vehicle by which spiritual subjugation was achieved and by which coloniality continues. Using these powerful ideas as his stepping off point, McKinney dissects South African language in education policy, illuminating the continued subjugation of the language practices of students from non-dominant groups. Again, the parallels with mainstream Australian education were really unavoidably striking for me. I found myself internally referencing the various standardized tests that we as teacher educators in Australia are kind of written into the roles of supporting these narrow tests, and thus unavoidably culpable in the systems and structures that we simultaneously seek to challenge. McKinney calls dominant language policy in education out for being a form of racism, rightly, one that reproduces the same patterns of privilege and disadvantage across pre- and post-apartheid South Africa, though now under a veneer of inclusion that is oftentimes beyond critique. But in putting forward a set of principles for dynamic bilingualism in practice, she also shows how liberatory work can and is taking place in spaces of opportunity, for example, outside of formal schooling, redrawing boundaries in bold, strategic, but unapologetic ways, which is perhaps a good place for me to stop, given that I think this speaks to the collection as a whole, strategic, hopeful, and inspiring. And I'm looking forward to finishing the rest of the book as soon as I finish my marking a marathon. Thanks so much for the opportunity, Joel.
And now I'd like to introduce Jenny Carter, who'll be talking about the Handbook of Critical Literacies.
So that's the book we're talking about. And the reason I wanted to show it to you is it's quite deceptive. It's sort of one of the attractive books that you buy off the shelf, Jennifer, but it's huge. It's a very big book. And so it's a little bit difficult to sort of render it in a 5-minute discussion, but I will try. I'm going to do two things. First of all, just outline the book and then give an example about some of the things that it raised for me in terms of things to think about. I know Barbara is following me and she will talk lots more about some of the other things I miss out. So thanks for the opportunity. It's very timely in many different ways. I'd call it urgent for this particular time and the issues that are facing the world globally. Also urgent in the Derridean sense of giving an ongoing ethical demand that is always already. As Jen Alford said at the beginning of the week, and I hope I got this right because I was listening in the car, it is about critical literacy as being both suave and spectacular. It's urgent work that can take a long time and is ongoing. This book is a handbook, and I looked up the definition of handbook on a very definitive source of Google, and the various definitions share an intent to provide information on doing something. So this book is actually about doing critical literacy and the context in which that is done. it says that the handbook is to answer the question, what are the social responsibilities of critical literacy academics, researchers and teachers in today's world? And it certainly gives a lot of food for thought about the challenges that presents. It also gives a brief definition at the beginning that critical literacy is classically understood as ways to interrogate text and context to address things like injustices and are essentially an essential literacy practice. This understates the book, which unpacks this definition across three sections and in a total of 40 chapters. I haven't read them all. The first section examines historical and contemporary configurations of critical literacy, and I've opened up the statement for the definition. It's an expansive book on the present, past and future of critical literacies on a transnational scale. The first section engages with critical literacy concepts and practices in current times, the impact of neoliberalism, the impact of increasing global mobility and the implications for language issues around youth activism, teacher education, media, and much, much more. The second section has 22 chapters and examines the state of critical literacy around the world, and there's a lot of places that get really particular attention. The third section provides some rather wide-ranging discussions for future research and some challenges around changing forms of text, planetary literacy, stratification, new conceptual demands and so forth. It's one of these books you want to read all at the same time. I would like to return to the notion of the urgency of this book by way of an example in teacher education. I teach in English and literacy curriculum, and we draw on a range of contemporary books that have strong affordances for critical literacy. So for example, we use Rabbits by John Marsden and Sean Tan, to examine this Australian book, examines the impact of Australia of colonialism, it's an allegory. I use the book The Duck and the Darkling by Glenda Millard and Stephen Michael King to examine environmental degradation and climate change, and none of these books have been particularly controversial. Another of these is The Little Refugee by Anne and Suzanne Doe and illustrated by Bruce Spotler. Now I've got it here. And if I had more time, I'd ask you to look very carefully at the cover, but we don't. But we could come back to that. Anne Doe is a well-known Australian comedian who arrived in Australia by boat following the Vietnam War. The blurb on the back of the book describes it as about one family's survival against the odds and the transforming power of hope. It tells the story of leaving Vietnam, the journey by boat, including being attacked by pirates, storms, thirst, and hunger and death. At that time, refugees to Australia lived in the community and were provided some support, particularly by the Catholic Church. The book tells of Anne's experiences of his family learning English, striving to do well at school, and making his parents proud when he was made class captain in year five. It is told with Anne's great sense of humour and hope. In our courses, we look at the language choices and resources that are made by the authors to tell the story in a sympathetic and hopeful way, which is a story essentially about violence. We look at the functional grammar and particularly the use of tenor. We develop a visual analysis. And I do want to quickly just finish this because the point is that when some of our students took this work that they'd done developing a unit around this book into a school, they were told they couldn't teach it because it was too controversial. And even though they talked back and said, well, you know, they were told that their role is not to engage in politics and that the teaching of the book was not appropriate. One of them talked back and said, well, you know, all teaching is political. That wasn't received very well. So, however, she still passed the placement. I think the problem is the ongoing erasure of critical literacy, which we've talked about before and is particularly pertinent here in Australia, so I won't sort of finish on that bit. But I think what the book does is give a lot of resources that are really important for us to consider and make sure that we can use it not only in our research but in our teaching to provide students with some really strong conceptual resources. I'd like to finish by saying that it's more than a handbook, it's actually a tour de force, and providing conceptual resources and challenging challenges for the urgency of the very slow and spectacular work that needs to be done. Thank you.
Evening, Barbara. We have Jessica speaking briefly, and if you don't mind closing the conference in your final conversation. So, oh. Jessica.
All righty. Well, thanks. First of all, what fabulous company, and now other books that I have to read. So I'm very excited. I want to say I have a few slides I can share. I think there is a definite, we're in a definite moment where folks want to work together. So I heard this with the other edited book that people, you know, there are coalitions, there are groups forming, and, you know, I've done a lot of scholarly work in somewhat of independent modes, but I sense it now that we all want to come together. So we want to do things together. And this handbook came out of a real urge to do that. This is my own critical literacy genealogy. I'm not going to go over the whole thing. I just want to show you. I've written all this down just to think about it. But I started reading Freire in 1995 when I was getting my teaching credential. And I've kept reading him. And I've, you know, met and worked with Alan Luke, who's a dear mentor of mine, and Barbara Comer, who's another dear mentor of mine, and written with other people. But about 5 years ago, Raul and I and Jen and Noah and Roberto de Rook, who's not here today, started this transnational critical literacy network. 5 years ago, I had to look that up. Yeah, it's old. And this was just a group of people, and it was a Google Doc. It actually still is just a Google Doc and a Google group. You're welcome to join. We'll put the link in the chat later. People who are doing critical literacy work. So you can go in there, you can look people up, you can say, is there anybody in that part of the world who's doing that? You can kind of look around and see what's going on. But out of that, one of the projects that came out of that was the handbook. So I just want to say that it came out of the network, and it was full of tension, some initial and some born in the process. So for instance, around language. So we wanted to have our chapters written in two languages. We wanted to offer English in the printed version and native language of authors in the electronic version. As you will maybe notice, there's only English. The win we had around that was only that people could write in whatever English they preferred. There was another tension just to even publish a book. So the network had a whole bunch of conversations about some folks just didn't want to be part of a commercial publishing enterprise. They wanted to publish in academic journals. They wanted to publish in state journals, but not in a handbook. So this is, you know, we all learned a lot about widening our own perspectives in the course of making a handbook that we thought was a great idea. And other people were like, yeah, don't want to be part of that. I want to do other work. That shouldn't be a capital H, but who is left out? And this is really a fundamental question for us. It still bothers me every few weeks. Raul knows what I'm talking about. Who isn't in this handbook? What countries, what regions are not represented? Who did we miss? What don't we know? Who don't we know? Whose voices are not there? So that's a kind of a permanent question for us. So I just want to say this, as you guys know, 5 editors from 4 different countries at the time, over 100 authors in this handbook. It has 3 areas, and our previous speaker said this so much, so I won't say too much, but the first area I edited, and it was about critical literacies over time, the sort of antecedents, where we've been. And then the second area was across space in this global survey, and Raul and Roberto de Rook edited this section. And that was probably the most wily section because we had such diversity of authors and places and ideas. And then the third area is pushing the boundaries. I just want to say that we all learned more than I think we ever signed up for in editing this handbook. And so my presentation is just to say to you that we feel like we're part of a much bigger enterprise. And I think that as scholars, we all feel the need to be part of a bigger enterprise these days. And this has been a great way for us to all engage with each other and feel a solidarity in this work and to also learn quite a lot about what we know and don't know. Now I want to turn it over to Barbara.
Thank you, Jessica, and thank you, Jenny, for your comments. I am given the task of having the final word, which is a bit of a worry because I don't think there'll ever be a final word. I'll just say a few things that I think are really significant for me about the handbook, and then, you know, make a few invitations, I guess, by way of finishing off my part of the Zoom anyway. For me, the most exciting thing about this handbook is that it is what I would say is the next generation of critical scholars. Some of you know I'm retiring at the end of January, and I do so really happily because it seems to me we're, in terms of scholarship and researchers, we're in such good shape that a group of early and mid-career scholars could work around the world to pull off this incredible task. And I know, you know, I'd chatted with Alan Luke some years ago now about this whole thing about handbooks and, like, you know, what was the function of a handbook and so on. And I love Jenny's emphasis on a handbook is something to help you know how to do. But sometimes handbooks have kind of got this thing, well, you know, I finally got asked to write in a handbook. I must be somebody academically. And this handbook is not like that. This handbook does the opposite. This handbook says, hey, you know what? There are all these folks out there doing incredibly important work in all sorts of places around the world. It deliberately invites people at different stages of career, people in different places around the globe, people who have great insights into the blind spots of previous versions of critical literacy. And it's the next generation of scholars whose, you know, whose names are there. And I just find that incredibly exciting. The other thing I want to say about it is that it is collaborative against the odds. It did happen across time and places and spaces. And I think the other thing that I think is really quite interesting about it is that it invited the contributors to be very self-conscious about our own work. And I don't mean self-conscious in the sense of, you know, as we've heard several times in this conference about being narcissistic. Self-conscious in this, in the sense that how we might actually produce our own text. And I had the incredible pleasure of working with George Lovell Boggs, Nerida Spinner, and Donna Alverman. And our chapter is called Critical Literacy Out of the Comfort Zone, Productive Textual Tantrums. And I have to say that, you know, working together to write our chapter was really, really hard work and at the same time really valuable work, because rather than talking about what we knew and perhaps giving people some kind of guide, what happened in the process is we found out what we took for granted, what we thought each other thought, what we hadn't thought about before, what we might need to think about in the future. And so for me, the most important thing about this handbook is that for me it is a kind of an open book that I can imagine, you know, the next generation of scholars, you know, you five are going to continue to work together, I have no doubt. And the people whose names are new in this handbook that people didn't know about before, I can't wait to see what they do next. So it's a very exciting handbook. I hope it gets photocopied. I hope it gets pirated. I hope it becomes viral. I hope people give each other free copies. I hope they give it to their, you know, political friends and so on. I just hope it gets shared incredibly widely. So, yeah, let's get all our librarians out there. Let's get our students photocopying it. Let's get it falling off the back of trucks, and let's get it read. So thank you very much to the wonderful editors. Thank you very much to the wonderful contributors. And I wish we were in the same room and we could crack open some bubbles and give each other some hugs. So well done. Before I finish, I just want to say, oh, there's Becky Rogers saying cheers to everyone, cheers, well done. And I want to say thank you to Becky, because when she invited me to go and speak at the Literacy Research Association conference, it was that idea that stayed with me about, you know, how can we work transnationally to make critical literacy go viral, that came from Becky's invitation. So I want to acknowledge the work that Becky has done in supporting so many scholars of different generations in different places, and to everybody here. And in closing, look, thank you so much to our conference conveners, to our conference roundtable presenters. And I'm not going to have the final word. I'm actually going to force Joel to at least come out and say goodbye. So that we can see you, Joel and Daniel, if you're on line, our conference conveners who did all the work. He's not standing up, he's not moving forward.
I am moving, okay, I'm rolling forwards. Barbara, thank you. This work is standing on the shoulders of your work, of Lynn Mario, of so many other, of Valkyria, of Paulo Freire, and so certainly would not be possible without the previous collaborations and support and struggles. So thank you to everybody who has contributed to critical social justice oriented research and practice and has been part of this meeting. And I hope we will have many more opportunities to meet again. So thank you all.